Hello and welcome to Round Ball Rules. Great to have you company where we can take a look at all of the biggest talking points in the wide world of football heading your way. Tara Rushton, great to have you company. And to be joined by Mark Milligan and Robbie Thomson, who has showed up with some shiny new shoes on. I have to draw some attention to them.
I don't think anyone can see them.
Oh, can we hold them up? Oh. They're pointy and I think they're good for dancing. Talk about dancing. We're going to have a very special guest join us a little bit later on in the show, but lots to get through, gents. Some huge coaching news straight off the top. The Bulls, there is a job up for offer. Talking about the MacArthur Bulls, who sit 1 point shy of finals of the top six at the moment. Ante Milicic, he's on the move. He's heading back to Croatia due to personal reasons. And to the both of you, look, I guess to the football fraternity, to those in the know of the game, wasn't too surprising, Robbie. I felt like there were murmurs that potentially he would be on the move back to Croatia at some time.
Yeah, I think that's been on the cards. I think it's been common knowledge around, like you say, around the football circles. It was just a matter of, were they going to announce it before the end of the season? Would they wait until the deal was done and he was gone before announcing it? From what I've seen this season and Ante on the bench, sometimes he just looks like he's so unhappy and getting so angry that maybe it's time for a change. Really, it seems, and we saw it on the weekend as well. It's everyone that's worked with him says that he's a great coach from the Matildas as well. They all loved working with him. Everyone's enjoyed working with Ante Milicic. I think he was a fantastic player. I remember watching him play in the old NSL days as well and with the Socceroos. Look, if it's what he wants, if it's time to go. It opens up a coaching opportunity for somebody else now as well. And onwards and upwards for MacArthur, hopefully.
The musical chairs, it does continue. We see it play out a lot. And it also becomes the question of, so who takes that spot? The name that keeps coming up again and again and again, and it seems to have happened with who is ever across the ditch or in our own backyard, being Wollongong, or Ufuk Talay. Great coach. What he's been able to do with the Wellington Phoenix, considering that he has been away from home, has been really admirable at the moment as well. How does he go at the Bulls? Does that seem like a natural fit?
Look, I think wherever Ufi goes next, he'll be successful. I think it'll take him time, I think, because I don't think he'll sacrifice too much on the way that he likes his teams to play. You know, whether that looks, what that looks like financially for him, a move to the Bulls rather than Wellington, I'm not really sure. But again, he's spent 2 years, we know he's a Sydney boy, he spent 2 years in Australia basically with Wellington, down in Wollongong and Park
and
Lee.
And Sydney, yeah.
So, yeah, does the family come into play on that? Look, I think it's a fantastic option for them. If they're able to get an Ufuk Talay, I'm not sure.
Is he the number one guy, though, when you think about who would be the best fit? I mean, whether he's available, whether he wants to. When you talk about the family situation, I heard that he moved his family. I mean, it's been back and forth over to NZ, and then I guess it depends what it looks like best
I
for his family circumstance.
There's family as well, but I mean, he's a football mad guy as well, and the family's been making sacrifices for years and years for Ufi's career, and I'm sure that will continue. You know what it's like when the families move around when you're a player. Same for coaching. I think if what you said in there, is he available? That's another huge thing. Mm-hmm. And we seem to have these clubs where the coach is always available, or is that just a perception? Your Newcastles, your Wellingtons, where you get your chance and then you move to perhaps, MacArthur's not a more established club, not traditionally necessarily, but they've got means, they've got potential.
They've got the budget.
They've got a budget. So, you know, it seems like following Roods, who went to a startup club and is now at Western Sydney from Wellington, there are progressions, there are avenues. I don't know what you think of that, but it's no surprise to me that the Pappas, the Talays come up in conversation when there's an opening. There's something in that as well.
How much
are they available? Can Wellington hold on to him?
Well, exactly.
If they want to? Yeah. I heard at the start of this season it was Ufi that said, I want to stay.
Yeah, well, you don't know what their plans are now as well, because the last 2 years COVID interrupted have been disastrous. Now it looks like he's on the cusp of finals in the first time in a few years, so you don't know what's being said behind the scenes there.
Yeah,
you know,
absolutely.
They might be banking that next season they're going to be back at home. They've been getting good crowds since they've been back at home. So I think there's a lot of discussions to that discussion.
What if another massive variant comes along and knocks us all for six again? Can Wellington
survive?
Then
I've got to invent a really good mask and cash in. Ivan Jolic, is he in the conversation as the assistant? I know that he followed him around Matilda's. He worked with Ante Milicic in as well. If you think about assistants getting a step up, is it too... I don't want to say it. It's not against what he can do, but it depends on what they want and who they want in this.
But these are club decisions as well that have to be made, and also for the people involved. I mean, if Ante's not going into a new job in Croatia and he's not taking staff with him, I mean, there's Mile Stojovski as well, who's at Northbridge Bulls and has been doing an assistant job with the first team as well. I mean, does he stay on in that NPL function that he has with the youngsters? Does he? I mean, you don't know what Ante's... Does Ante want the squad to go with him, his team of coaches? These are all discussions that need to be had. And, you know, there are coaches that go with their full staff, including video analysis, including fitness coaches. There are others that are lone guns for hire that will just fit into a system.
Yeah, what the announcement does, having it now, though...
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, it allows for the club to prepare for what's next and talk to all people that they think are...
Yeah.
Up for that role.
Perth Glory are another one that are in a similar situation as well, where there's time before the end of the season. We don't know exactly what's going to happen there. There are lots of rumours about.
Let's just start throwing about six names into the mix and we'll
just see. Well, let's start with six clubs and then even more names. Sven-Goran Eriksson.
And Dwight York. That came out today as well, that Dwight York has potentially been linked to Perth Glory, and he will also be confirmed as the A-League All-Stars coach when they face Barcelona, that one just before the grand final. Moving on with some more transfer news. Keanu Backus is on the way to Scotland, where you have plied your trade for Hibs over there. Good move for Keanu. He scored, I remember, that cracking goal in the derby, the Western Sydney boy born and bred from there, but he's played a bucket load of A-League men's games, 104 in total. He's 23 years old and really young, so pretty exciting to see him on the move.
Yeah, I think Scotland's a fantastic move for any young, especially Aussie player. It's look, the league is very strong. It's a very, very honest league. I remember when I was there, you know, they used to speak about it and compare it to down south, and I think there's as much quality there, but obviously not the pay packets that follow necessarily, so you really have to work and earn your trade, and they very much do that. You know, while you do have those bigger clubs like your Celtic and Rangers, and then the ones that sort of fall just under that, obviously start to think about Hibs and Hearts, even Aberdeen, you know,
Dundee's every now and again.
Well, exactly. So it is a very competitive league. I like the way that they run it. They've split the league now, the top six and bottom six who play off, so they get more games. But like I said, from a young player's point of view, I don't think there's much of a better place to be going and playing. I think you have two over there now who are a perfect example of that, in Atkinson and Kenny Devlin, who are both done wonderfully.
Tommy Rogic, new lease on life.
Of course, and Tommy's been there for a long time. Yeah. And then you only have to think back, not that long ago, when you had players like Muskie, Moore.
Craig Moore, Tony Vidmar.
Was it
Rangers as well?
It has been a happy place for Australian players.
That's when Australians were Rangers fans. Now it's more the Celtic side of things.
And I guess this connection, it brings us to the broader picture of the domestic transfer system. And I kind of say it with, big conversation. It's a big conversation when I look over there and I see the green and gold of the Socceroos. Because this comes up constantly.
I was hoping you weren't looking at me.
Consistently. About how we better develop the youth and give them the best tools so that they can go on and build a national team that can be competitive against the best teams in the world. And I know that this is something that Football Australia and James Johnson have been spearheading in this new push for a domestic transfer system. Fees, so that each club where you're on selling to and years that the player has been at the club will get remunerated. So there is actually something in it for the A-League teams here.
Not A-League yet. This is one
FA
of the confusing...
APL.
Exactly. So this is... I think on paper, I was part of the a Zoom call we had where it was presented, and it is a difficult one to get your head around. But on paper, basically, NPL clubs can contract their players, and then if you sign someone to a four-year deal, you can sell them on and get compensation, basically, for that 4 years of contract that remains. At the moment, that's capped, so there's no incentive to develop players, so sign them to contracts.
Is that like a flat fee? So it can only be up to X amount of...
At the moment, yes. Or until now, yeah, it's been 50% of the salary yes. remaining. So it's you're basically operating at a loss. Mm. So now it's coming into line with the traditional transfer system that we all know. If I sign you to a three-year deal, then if someone wants to buy you, well, I get however much yes. money for a Mark Milligan now to sell you on. That's for MPL. MPL can sell to A-League, they can sell to overseas, they can sell wherever. A-League has to follow that for the whole thing to work, because at the moment there's no transfers in between A-League clubs. That's an APL discussion that now has to follow, but the FA have set this up with an eye on second division, eventually promotion relegation as well, and create this fluid movement of players. Best players come through, get game time in a professional environment, sign for first division, eventually sign overseas. But the easiest way to describe it is that this is what the rest of the world does, and this is what they're trying to instigate here. And on paper, it works.
Yeah, on paper it does, yeah. But I think you need to be very careful, especially when we talk NPL and young yeah. players. There's only one other league in the world that has a salary cap. Mm. So we're not like the rest of the world.
No, in that respect.
We don't have 1,000 professional clubs to choose from. We have 12 at the moment.
Yeah.
What's to stop these 12 A-League clubs stockpiling young players and limiting game time even more because of the potential that they may have down the track? I think the leagues here at the moment at NPL level, obviously I probably have more of an insight now into New South Wales rather than any other states. I think they've got a lot of things they need to sort out well before they start thinking about any sort of transfer system
for young players. What about promotion relegation? You're saying
it would be wonderful.
Yeah,
but I just can't see how it's feasible. Like, it's lovely to say.
Yeah.
But
this is the whole point. I think this is part of a bigger picture, which is
you
MPL clubs now, you if you want to get a transfer fee for this player, you've got to get them on contract. You've got to go full professional. And we're going to see a lot of clubs are going to have to put their money where their mouth is and
Correct.
Say, yeah, we want second division.
Correct.
We want our shot at it. Okay, we've got to go full pro
yes.
now at this level. And knowing that it's going to be hard to make ends meet.
Yeah,
it's a big... big thing that's very complicated.
You were in the Zooms and in the meetings. Is there a time frame that you think this could potentially roll out? And I know the big point that keeps getting, I guess, hammered home is they are doing this all over the world. This is normal practice.
Yeah.
And I know that this league is different, but there needs to be more, it feels like there needs to be more incentive here.
I think we need to improve youth development. Oh. I think everyone agrees with yeah. that. If this is a way of encouraging that,
yes.
then surely that's a positive step forward.
Yeah, but like I said, I think there's a lot of steps before we get... When we talk youth development, we want to talk youth development...
It's got to be in the...
Right now at MPL level, at the start of the season. So teams have a point system. Mm. Yeah, and obviously they get to the end of that window leading into the season. Teams get a sniff that they might be able to get a more experienced player, so then young players are the ones that get shifted on on deadline day. Then where do they go? They can't sign anywhere because there's no more transfer window until nearly the end of the season. So now all of a sudden young players who are getting shafted out to let older ones come in now have to go and play club football.
Yeah, but this will eventually filter itself down and work itself out, won't it? Is this part of a shakedown system?
You'd like to think so, but I can't see what the starting point is.
Yeah, well, the starting point, whatever it's going to be, is going to be rocky, I think, for a couple of years, including when for trying to get MPL players to A-League as well.
And then also on selling the players from, the A-League clubs to the other club, I, in my head, have that the clubs with the bigger budgets are going to be the ones that benefit the most.
But
the facilities again? Because I know in the three, it was a transfer windows, creation of a transfer fee, and then the training compensation system, which is what you're talking about with the NPL as well. So three tiers that's been looked into. I mean, it's a huge process to get to even. We're not. The competitions aren't even aligned.
But it's happening now for NPL as of next season. This is the way it's going to
be in
place. Yeah. So moving forward.
And
then the onus is on APL with A-League to follow suit to say, okay, now we're going free market for
transfer
players,
fees, more windows.
How does that? Well, I was going to say, how does that work with windows? Because NPL seasons don't run the same as A League seasons.
That's what they're going to try and.
They're trying to mirror them up, right?
Yeah, NPL will try and switch to a calendar that operates with A League.
You should have been on that Zoom call because I was doing some research and listening to what James Johnson was saying about it, and I on a podcast last night, and it did leave a lot of questions considering how tricky it will be, but the leagues aren't aligned for number one when you talk about the NPL and I guess trading players and whatnot. It's the windows aren't there. So before you even talk about transfer windows.
I think it's curious how NPL teams at any level can compete with A-League teams when from a money perspective.
No, they can't at the moment. But that's the whole idea of setting up this pyramid, of a footballing pyramid, where you will eventually have, in theory, access to the top flight. I mean, in theory, on paper, this is.
Watch this space, huh? Mm. We'll get back into the
weeds.
I don't
think that was the most convincing chat, guys.
I got a lot of questions about this conversation. We'll check back in with how that whole process is going. Looking at the race for the Premier's plate, fair to say that Melbourne Victory are out of contention. And when you look at it, it's Melbourne City and Western United. Western United's potentially to lose. So City atop on 46 points, 2 games left. Western United 44 points and 3 games left. I mean, you can see Victory, it is pretty close there on 42.
Yeah, I think Western United's to lose now, especially considering Melbourne City are coming back from two fairly full-on weeks in Thailand.
Well, it's two massive weeks, just from a footballing perspective.
Yeah,
take away the travel and everything like that.
Yeah. And the fact that there are players that are going to be really struggling when they come back from that. And they've got 2 games, they still have to finish the season, with an eye on finals as well.
And they're close together as well, the 2 games.
Yeah.
That's not,
exactly.
That's not a 7-8-day breakdown between them. No.
So Melbourne City have Perth Glory away, then they host Wellington Phoenix, and then Western United, they play the Central Coast Mariners away, and then the Newcastle Jets away. I wonder if they're going to base themselves up on the Central Coast or in Newcastle for those final 2 games. It is. I mean, when I look at those two, when I look at Western United's final 2 games and the Mariners away and the Jets away, that actually feels super tough to me.
Yeah. But they've got an extra game in hand, the Mariners, on the MacArthurs and the Sydney FCs as well. So they've still got a little bit of leeway. Basically, by my calculations, we're looking, the maximum MacArthur can have is 38 points. The maximum Sydney is 37. The other teams are almost there. So, and once that point is done, then you're jostling for positions within the six. But the only doubt is really over Mariners, and I think it looks to me like the Mariners will get across the line.
I feel like that's the popular vote, because everyone wants to see
After what we saw on the weekend.
everyone wants to see the Mariners play finals, which is, it was a super exciting F3 derby, arguably one of the games of the season that we watched on the weekend. 4-2, red card, cheeky elbow to the back of the head, a little bit of drama in that one as well. Love talking about Adelaide United, love Cooper Stadium, one of the best stadiums, I mean, it depends who you're talking to, in the country. And what Viet has been able to do at this site, especially with the young players. And at times during the season, it felt like he was decimated with his players, with some of his most experienced players at the start of the season leaving and going abroad.
Mm. Yeah, and we spoke about this the other night. I think the benefit that Adelaide have had compared to like a Perth, who at the moment are forced to play, they've very much been able to control when the young ones come in. He's still lot of the time had access to the likes of Goodwin, having those players next.
He's had his Spaniards.
He's had the Spaniards. Yes, exactly. Who's able to lead those younger ones. And not that he's used the younger ones sparingly, because I don't think it's like that at all. I just think that
no, but he's been able to manage them well, hasn't he?
Yes, and he's been able to use them as impact. He hasn't relied on them to go and get results week in, week out.
Yeah. No, I've been impressed. And I should say, and we should say, that last week we chatted about potential coach of the year chat, and Carl Viet was omitted from that chat on this couch. So I think that was probably an oversight. Carl Viet is in that conversation somewhere, because he has done a fantastic job managing everything. And they haven't... They've had border issues themselves throughout the season as well. They did have their moments. They're finishing the season with 3 home games. Home form hasn't been amazing, but no, they've done a good job. But I commentated their last game, and the Spaniards, they are really key to what that Adelaide, and I just love the fact that I think between the three of them, they've got 18 or 19 yellow cards as well. They're the people of your heart.
Your friends.
No, but they are the backbone in terms of experience, in terms of leadership, and they are also the backbone. They set the tone for the team to follow. And they've had it tough. They lost Halloran, they lost Mork in the season, they lost Yenge, who scored their first goal, they lost him to injury for the whole season, they lost goalkeepers. I mean, they've had a tough run as well. No, it hasn't been smooth sailing. And they've found, they lost Ross Aloisi, to who's gone off to join Muskie at Yokohama F Marinos. So, you know, I think there's a really interesting conversation to have about Adelaide, which is just how they're prepared to sell anyone. Yeah. And that they're, you know, not saying the football is secondary, because they've got football people in place who are working very hard to get the job done. But above that, they're prepared to sell, bring in youngsters, give them the chance, try and manage them. But they are a modern footballing institution at the moment, and it's an interesting one to keep an eye on.
Well, yeah, exactly. You mentioned Mork and Halloran. Yeah. I think the only time this year you saw any sort of slip in form was when Goodwin had COVID.
So they've done it clever.
Yeah, absolutely.
One of the highlights of the weekend, I know we did touch on it, was the F3 Derby, what Nick Montgomery has been able to do with the club and the A-League competition that has the shoestring budget when it comes to facilities as well. They aren't up there when you compare it to what the rest of the league has had. And it feels like good news is coming for the club on the Central Coast, with an injection of investment expected to happen and to be announced in the next month or so, hearing that there'll be a new chairman in place. And when we talk about investment, it's substantial investment, not just over the next year, but over the next few years. At the moment, they're just going through the fit and proper persons testing to ensure that they can tick every box. But that's really exciting news, especially for the Central Coast Mariners fans. Love this club, one of the original clubs in 05, they were in the competition. But great news to see what this club could do and the potential it could become with a bit of additional funding.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, anyone who's getting into the A-League for the right reasons is obviously welcomed, and I think Montgomery's done a fantastic job there, and probably a lot of it is down to what Stadge did last year, because that was amazing what Stadge was able to achieve, and then Montgomery stepping in and, you know, being successful as well. That I think if you don't have those 2 years, then you're potentially not looking at someone coming in with this type of investment to help grow the club.
And we've heard as well that part of this is going to be Montgomery staying on as well. It's not going to be wholesale change and rupture and trauma at every level. I think it's what's most encouraging is that for Mariners fans, and the fact that they've got that academy that's producing kids that we're seeing. Monty was part of that. He was coached there. Now he's senior coach. There seems to be avenues and progress and coherence in what they're doing there at the moment. And probably with a little bit of money, if it doesn't spoil the whole thing, that progression is coherence. Yeah, well, it's so important.
Like we spoke about Adelaide just a few minutes ago, about that's what we used to speak about as the Mariners, you know, a few years back. So we know that's there. That, I guess, that pipeline is there. It's just about rediscovering it again.
He's made some pretty good signings, though, as well, Nick Montgomery. I know that they did incredibly well last season under Alan Stajic, but when I look at Jason Cummins, Benny and Kalolo, you know, first time out of Australia. So in a little bit, you have to do your research to see how these players are going to go. Urena's sitting on the bench at the moment. You've got Mark Birragidi, who is in the form of his life. Josh Nisbet and the way that he plays. Kai Rolls, another Socceroo as well. When you think about cult heroes and players that people want to fall in love with, the characters in the game, and that's what gives it a little bit of that extra. I feel like I look at this Mariners side and it's like, yeah, I'm on this ride with you. You're taking me with you with all of those bits. And then with the additional investment, I mean, the opportunities do feel limitless, hopefully.
Yeah, well, I think you go away from that, and obviously, yes, some fantastic signings, some fantastic players. I think they have one of the best stadiums in the country to go to play at, and as a fan as well, I've been there, and it's fantastic. You know, the Central Coast, we've seen, very much gets behind the club, maybe when they're doing well.
Yeah, which, but they do.
But they do get there. I know, well, my mum's a big Marinator supporter. And
is she really?
Yeah, came to a Victory game once with a Victory jacket on. We got there and she took it off and she had a Mariners jersey. That's how big a Mariners fan she is. So, but they have that base there. And like I said, the last 2 years, I think we can't forget what Stadge did there last year. Yeah. And Montgomery has very much built on it. And now with this investment, I think it's exciting times for the people of the Central Coast.
You know what annoys me as a... it's not annoying, but how many times I'll be sitting pitch side and the cannon, you know it's about to go off because the Mariners have scored a belter, and it still scares the daylight out of me. Just like, you know it's going to... You know, how many times have you been sitting on that pitch? Anyway, and in good news as well for the rest of the league, we're expecting an announcement that there'll be new ownership deals for Adelaide United and the Newcastle Jets, which will be announced before the end of the season. So some really positive news when you look at where the A-League competition is going as a whole. Looking at the Socceroos, hearing the news that... Oh, well, we can just break the news. The Socceroos will be playing a friendly against Jordan in the lead-up to their sudden death. I mean, they have to win it, or it's not even worth talking about the clash with Peru. But before they meet UAE on the 7th of June, they'll be playing Jordan. Good move.
Very good.
Important.
Absolutely. Nothing more. There's not a whole lot to say. We need to play matches.
Correct. Yes.
If you can play a friendly match against a side from that part of the world as well, it's all important, all good.
I guess my only question is, and it is our job to talk about football, yes, and the Socceroos, yes. It does feel like there are a lot of, not necessarily new names, but as we look at the last qualifiers that were played, and there's a list of 50, say, that Graham Arnold will potentially be looking at, would you really expect...
51 with Curtis Good.
I was going to say, I hope there's a list of 50.
Is he on the list? Will he be allowed to go? Are you, Millsy, expecting when the squad gets named any new faces, realistically, when it is this high stakes? If the Socceroos lose this, forget what's in the future. It's done.
Yeah, well, what it does do, having this extra game now, is it'll allow him to bring in a few more players. I think probably the only new name we might see will be Cammy Devlin. I think
is
definitely...
I feel like he's been a bit unlucky to not be in earlier.
Yeah, well, from what I'd heard, there was a chance of him coming in a little bit earlier, but he had an injury over in Scotland.
That's
right. Which kept him out, but he's back from that now. He's playing some fantastic footy again with Hearts. So in terms of new faces, I think that might be the only sort of one. But, I think...
Jason Cummings, not yet.
Oh, that's a no from you, isn't it?
No, I don't want to play this game.
No, it was just an innocent question.
There is a game.
Question.
Jason
there is so
Davidson?
Much talk.
Jason Davidson, yes. I think Guerrier as well.
Who else you got?
Jason. Jason.
The Jason.
So it's the Jason game.
The Jason.
Okay.
The Jason. Jasons.
But I wonder, because I know there's been some really strong performances, and I guess it's when you start to look
at
the positions.
There have also
been,
Tara, a lot of people missing.
Correct.
In games, and if they come back, then that's going to reshuffle all those cards again. Moy wasn't there, Rogic. I mean, there's a long list of players that weren't there. If they come back, if they're in form, you know, it's a different proposition to play for the Socceroos
which makes the friendly v Jordan all the more important when you have players back and in contention for the almighty all important.
But this is
game
not a this is not a game to be. Trying or
no, but you're assuming the time of the year as well. It's end of season. They're going to have a chance to get everybody's body right.
So
everyone you're thinking should, unless there's something serious that they have to deal with players, everyone should be in contention.
Yeah, it's 2 weeks after the end of the season, isn't it? So everyone's sort of finished with that, into camp, hopefully, with a good, solid camp, sort everyone out, get everyone flying on
top. Do you think Bruno's back?
Got a sore foot, doesn't he?
Well, I haven't seen him. He hasn't played for
ankle.
For
he hasn't played yet since he's been back. And the word out of Perth is that season is compromised. But then again, there'll be an extra... Well, he'll have an extra month, 6 weeks.
Yeah.
There could be a FA Cup, Australia Cup playoff match. Well, there will be for Perth, a playoff match in early May as well, which is...
I was just trying to think of what the date was.
I think it's between the 12th and 15th.
Okay.
There's going to be...
They will be
they're playing those playoff matches that we had at the start of this season. Exactly, they'll be playing those playoff matches for the last 64. But that's a That's a different debate, isn't it?
That is another debate. Sorry, I wasn't even supposed to get into Socceroos debate, but I just started throwing those questions about all the Jasons your way, Millsy. I thought I might just put you in the hot seat. Talking about Socceroos, Denny Jeanreau, fantastic news for Denny Jeanreau and his team Toulouse. I should ask the Frenchman about his promotion to Liga. Because he is the first Australian that will be playing in the top league in France since Milos Sojovski, which is back in 2004.
With Lille.
Fantastic news.
It is fantastic news. Great. I was there for 20 years and Milos was the only one that ever played for me to get excited about. There have been lots of girls who have come across
of course,
played in the women's first division as well. And Ellie Carpenter's there at the moment playing for Lyon. But great for Denny Jeanreau. Started 19 matches. He was more or less first cab off the rank in midfield. They have some really talented players, Toulouse. It's rugby town, Toulouse, in the southwest. So they're more famous for their rugby team, which is multiple European champions. So they're a bit of a yo-yo club, but they've had some fantastic players. Fabien Barthez started his career at Toulouse. He's from that part of the world. André-Pierre Gignac, who nearly won the Euro for France, he came through Toulouse. They've had some great players. Etienne Capoue, who's in the Champions League tomorrow morning with Villarreal, is a Toulouse youth player. But great this generation coming up back into the top flight, fantastic. And he's played his part. One goal, three assists, but he's been they're very happy with him, very happy with him.
That is great. His mum and dad were in the crowd watching
for them against Niort. Yep.
Which is so exciting. 2-0 was that final result. He joins Matt Ryan at Real Sociedad and Aidan Hrustic, who plays at Eintracht Frankfurt.
And they may have a couple more Aussies in France next year as well.
Oh, of course, yes.
Don't know if they'll be necessarily playing in Ligue 1.
Okay.
In Ligue 1, hopefully.
What's your mail?
No, that's it.
Okay.
That's my mail.
We'll have to get you in the hot seat. You'll be on the hot seat
next.
That's
the full extent of my mail.
The mail is still getting delivered but hasn't yet arrived in the letterbox. We are off to a short break. On the other side, a huge guest joins us on the couch, one of Network 10's very own Duncan. Welcome back to Round Ball Rules. Like that cool camera move there, where we are joined by a very special guest, Studio 10's very own and Network 10 as well, Tristan MacManus. Great to see you.
How are you? Thanks for having
Thank you so much for joining us. You know a little bit about how to use those feet, okay? So I know there's a love of dancing and a love of football, but what did come first?
Football. Always football.
It was
my first love, still is. I'm just an armchair fan now who tells professional footballers what they should be doing.
But
I've always wanted to play. Obviously played through my youth, quit for a few years because of dancing.
Yes.
And then since I've come back to Australia, I went back to play just locally.
Yeah.
And I absolutely love it.
I mean, what level were you playing at? From Bray, right? Sunny southeast.
Sunny southeast
of Ireland.
No, I was one of those kids who showed a lot of talent as a child. And then when I got to the next stage, it wasn't quite there.
Okay. I
come from Bray Wanderers. And at the time when I was growing up, they had a player who played for Newcastle. Mm-hmm. Kenny Dalglish was the manager at the time. And Damien Duff's agent was the Bray Wanderers manager at the time. So they made a connection. And then Newcastle brought over a school of excellence for kids aged between...
And set it up in Bray.
And set it up in Bray, through their connections there. I think it might have even been part of the deal for Damien Duff.
Okay.
But it was four kids... In the leagues up till the age of 16.
Yes.
So I kind of fell into that age bracket, and I thought I've absolutely made it. But my talent didn't go far as my love for football, unfortunately. But I played there. So I don't want to say semi-professional, but it's
a pretty good level,
I
a decent
the standard
level.
That I should have played at.
What position do you play?
I used to play up front.
Yes.
And then I moved to the wing. I used to be really really fast, and then I had a knee operation through dancing, and I kind of work between centre back and right back now at the moment.
That's interesting.
How did you get into dancing?
Yeah.
Well, my grandparents were social dancers at the time. Mm-hmm. My father was in the army, so he travelled a lot. So we spent a lot of the weekends with my grandparents. And they just brought me along to it. It wasn't something I chose.
Yeah.
But obviously, being a young man in Ireland doing ballroom dancing, there wasn't too many. So you kind of got your pick. You had a lot of dance partners.
Yeah.
And I guess I had a bit of rhythm, I had a bit of talent for it, and it was something that
less
I did.
Less competition than on the wing.
Well, that's it. I had maybe talent at the time that no one else was shown because there probably wasn't too many boys in there. But it was something I did. It wasn't necessarily something I chose.
How did that go down with your football team and your teammates and that balance?
Well, this was the thing, because it was a secret for so many years.
Yeah.
At least what I didn't know is my parents told my football manager, but he didn't tell the team. So it was something that I was quite embarrassed about at the time, so I didn't tell anyone. And I used to play a football match in the morning. Yeah. And then I'd go to a competition from there.
Full Billy Elliot.
Wow. Yeah. I'd have my high pants on and my high shoes, but and mucky knees.
Yeah.
But if there was a weekend where there might have been a competition in the UK or whatever, I was spending the weekend with my grandparents.
Yeah.
So that's kind of the way it went. And it got to a stage where
I was
told...
Good on you for sticking with it and doing it, though.
Yeah, in hindsight, it was a great thing to do.
Absolutely.
And it gave me the same kind of determination that I think football would have.
Mm-hmm.
It got my fitness up.
Yeah.
It got me... It had discipline. And that's certainly, as a child, what I needed most.
And how do you go running around on the weekends now? Because you have kids. So it's usually, you know, mum or dad are divvying up who's going to kickers or the pitch.
Yeah.
But you say that you still have a kick around as well.
Yeah, I like to. I played, because when we moved to Australia 5 or 6 years ago, we moved here because my daughter was being born.
Mm.
But I didn't know anyone here. So the easiest way for me, if it wasn't true drinking, it was go to play football, because that's what we did.
Yeah.
So I signed up for the local team, Cronulla Seagulls. That was 80% Irish on that team. And then I absolutely loved it. So I played for a couple of seasons until I had a heart attack, which put me out for a couple of years. And then you kind of prioritize about what you can and can't do. I have a kick about now at the moment. I haven't signed for a team, but I am looking. But my daughter plays now. So my daughter's 6 years old. She plays
for
Lily
Pilly. I play over 45s, but you'll have to wait a bit before you can get there.
There we go. Well, I think when I was, like, I could have played over 35s, and I was like, nah, I'm going to play all age. And I think that was probably one of the worst decisions of my life.
So you did just skim over the fact that you did have a heart attack whilst you were playing. I have heard you talk about it before, and you've shared your story on Studio 10 as well. How is your heart now?
I'm fine. I'm fine. Like I said, it's kind of... You know yourself, you go through life with different lifestyles at different times and different priorities. I probably didn't look after myself enough in the first half of my life, but certainly reassessed everything when the kids came along. What it ended up being was that...
It wasn't because of that. It wasn't directly because
of that. For sure it had an influence in it as well. I come from a place where when you were sick or if you were injured... You just push through, and that's what we do. Because if you get kicked and you stay down, you're soft, you know. So it was kind of all the time. So what happened to me in this last scenario is that I had the flu, and I was trying to get rid of it. And generally, the last couple of days of your flu, my thought was I'll just run it out of me.
Yeah,
I'll run
it out.
I'll be fine. I'll sweat it out.
And that
was usually the goal for a long time. And it was the last game of the season as well. So I said I don't want to miss this game either.
Yeah.
It was a pretty hot day. I was sprinting up and down. It was pretty early doors in the game. I was playing centre midfield that day. Maybe that's what I was. I was running and then I started getting a little bit dizzy. My chest started to tighten up, and I thought this isn't right here. So I kind of walked through the game. I always remember the ball came towards me. I just punched it. Everyone's screaming at me for doing it. And I took my jersey off because I was pounding my chest to try and release the kind of tightness
in
it.
You could feel it was there.
I could feel it there. Yeah, I knew something was weird. And I was like, maybe it's just a muscle knot from... But I tried to knock it out. I was banging my chest. And there was people watching the game. And they're like, look at this guy. Ooh, you love your team and stuff. I was like, I'm dying here. It was one of those ones. But I'll never forget it. The abuse I was getting until they realized I was actually having a heart attack. So I haven't played competitively since then.
Yes.
However,
the advice from the specialist and the doctor?
It was my own advice to myself.
Okay.
Take it easy.
Take it easy. Yeah. You've got your kid. Tahina, my wife, was coming to watch the game.
I was wondering if your wife and your kids were there.
She'd just come to the game, and Echo was a baby at the time. She was carrying her, so I was very aware that I focused towards them. I could see them. They didn't know what was going on, so I tried to put my jersey back on. I put my head through the arm sleeve, and I kind of just sat down. it was a very sobering experience.
That.
It was, but that being said. I look after myself a lot more. I've gone back. Yeah. I still run. I still swim. Yeah, I still cycle. I'm a bit of a kind of triathlete in my heart. But I'm looking to go back to football. And I hopefully, if it's not the end of this season, we don't know what's going on now. Yeah. But maybe it'll be next season.
Do you have to? Did you have to take any? Was it the artery, the heart muscle that you?
Yeah, your arteries sit on top of your heart. Mine go through and they come out the other side.
Yes.
So if there's inflammation in my body, pericarditis and myocarditis, the muscles, it clamps on. And that's essentially what happened. So I'm not on medication of any kind.
Okay.
I do make sure I get my heart checked, like everyone should.
Yes.
But as far as anything else, it's just a case of listening to your body and being smart.
Yeah.
So that's where I am.
Wow.
I mean, yes, because you're talking about football and then you have a heart attack on the final game of the season. But great to bring awareness to it as well, because I think as well, when you talk about your health and just pushing on, many people will do that as well. And they 100%. Think, oh, I think something's wrong.
Yeah.
No, actually, it's okay until you're
And it's one of those things as well.
Like
it's kind of, you can hear it so much, but until you take the information in, I mean, unfortunately, I've lost friends as well who had sudden death syndrome from playing football.
Oh,
there was
gosh.
A period where there was a lot of young sports stars who unfortunately were dropping, and they didn't know what was wrong with anyone. And even with that going on, I was still in my head, well, this is how I react to things.
Yeah.
It's just a case that the support is there. Mm. We just need to start taking it.
The football love, it obviously runs through your veins, especially when you're still playing, going through a moment like that. You're a huge Leeds fan.
Yes.
Is that correct? I mean, I'd love to hear what you've thought of their season so far and the new coach coming in.
Yeah.
US coach as well, which is quite an interesting move.
Yeah, for sure it is. It's been a funny season. I mean, it's been a funny season for every team, you know, and kind of Marcelo Bielsa, when he came in, he was exactly what we needed. He was everything. He changed from top to bottom. I was listening to your conversations earlier on about how clubs are run and kind of the impact that it has. It's almost, he's almost like a grassroots manager straight through to the Premiership.
Yeah.
He's on everything. And it's his passion for the football that's pushed Leeds on. He's taken Championship players. We were at the bottom of the Championship when he took on, having just come up from League One.
Yeah.
And he changed the mentality of everyone. He changed the fitness levels, the professionalism of everyone. It's almost hard to say anything negative about Marcelo Bielsa because of what he's done for the club.
Yeah.
But everyone has a cycle, and that's what it's come to. Jesse Marsh has come in. He's got new ideas. He's kind of from the Ralph Rangnick school, which for a Leeds fan probably wasn't the thing you want to hear when he's looking after Manchester United.
Yeah.
But again, he's a young coach and he's plied his trade. He's been there. He's been in Germany. He's done a fantastic job.
Mm.
He's at Salzburg. He's done a fantastic job. And now he's had a great, I believe he had a great start for Leeds now, because it's a very tough job to come into, and he lost his first two games and everyone lost their mind.
Yeah.
He's going to try things, but his thought right now is, I need to make sure we don't get relegated this season. And that's a genuine concern.
That's all that counts.
And then unfortunately, and I hate saying it, there's a cycle with the players that we have at the moment that it's starting to change, and summer is where that needs to be. It's not a case of getting rid of everyone.
This is where the club,
we need to add.
But this is where the club and the directors and everyone earn their stripes, isn't it? By making the changes, the right changes.
Yeah.
And I think it's funny that you go from Bielsa and the religious school that is Marcelo Bielsa and everything that he brings to the table, to then go to the new religion, which is Rangnick religion as well, which is kind of even, it's Bielsa on even more drugs
in terms of
high press and running and madness with.
And they're not too dissimilar
the
way they do things. It's just looking at a different. I mean, you know Bielsa well
from his time
in France.
Yeah,
but it's,
I know that he wanted everything had to be perfect, like you say. He had his finger in every pie. He knew everyone at the club. Every single person at Marseille was an important person, and fantastic stories to come out of it as well, of going to say goodbye to people at the club and local, you know, the local fruit and veg seller and stuff in Marseille that would always look after him and stuff. He made sure before he left, and he left after one game of the season. I mean, he was like, okay, this isn't working.
Yeah.
We can't go on.
Yes.
And just left. And that was it.
Is there belief in Jesse Marsh from Leeds fans? Are they kind of... And I know that it's just, let's not get relegated, which is front and centre of mind, so it doesn't necessarily matter how it's done, just get it done in terms of results. But is there a bit of...
Do you know what? I think there is full belief there, and there should be.
Yeah.
But at the same time, it's more in the sense of how Bielsa was changed.
Yeah,
I think that's the thing that sits... kind of a bit uneasy with people. And Raja Rezani has come out and said he probably shouldn't have done it that way. Mm. However, when you're on that top job, they're the big decisions that you have to make.
Yeah.
And that's your bread and butter. Mm. I think there's a lot of talk as well, because there's a takeover talk with Leeds, with the 49ers coming into it
talk
as well.
Everywhere.
Mm. There really is.
It's just non-stop now. And these football clubs are crazy.
It's an easy thing to kind of say, well, you're here for the money grab. And you kind of forget about what he's done for the club, because it's his money that he was pumping in. Mm. So I think there's going to be that bedding down period. It's an awful lot easier to accept the new manager when you're getting the results.
Is there not a feeling of, and I'm not saying the English or Leeds fans would be racist, but the sort of thing that Ange Postecoglou had when he got to Celtic, my God, we've gone from Marcelo Bielsa to an American.
Yeah. And then
exactly.
Yeah,
and we've got this Australian and proved himself. And I'm sure Jesse Marsh was aware of that would be the case. And it was probably the case in Salzburg as well. I mean, he speaks perfect German as well, which would have helped there. And he probably speaks very good English.
Yeah.
Do they speak English at Leeds?
Yeah. I think the main thing with that is that was addressed straight away.
Yeah.
And I think that was so important for him to do that in his first press conference. He said, these are the things that you're going to hit at me. This is the reality of the situation. And I think people appreciate that. He's almost...
But football has changed now. You don't,
100%.
You know, you can have a great American coach. I mean, Bob Bradley has been coaching in and around Europe. Hasn't had the...
Didn't work out for him too well there. Yeah,
didn't
but for
work
sure.
out for him yet, but... It will keep coming. It will keep happening.
100%. For someone it will. And again, I believe that's the same. I mean, Ange is doing a fantastic job at
incredible.
Celtic. And there was a time when he came in first where people went, this Australian guy.
Yeah.
Or
what
this
are we
American
doing?
Guy. Or what are we going to do?
Arsene Wenger had it.
Yes. 100%.
When it arrived from Japan.
Yeah.
What?
And it's easy to remember that Bielsa didn't win too much before he came to Leeds.
Yes. Exactly. Only with Chile, really.
Well, that's it. Yeah. That's it. But look at Jesse Marsh. He'll take his summer. I think he's going to be fantastic going forward. There's just... It's hard for people to accept something that they love so much is gone.
You know, there's a lot of love for Leeds in Australia as well, obviously, thanks to
that
golden generation.
Yeah, of course. you had Kiel, you had the Duke, who I still think is the best player I've probably ever seen with my own eyes. You forget about Shane Cancel-Sheriff. We had Nathan Byrne was there as well.
Burns was there. I think Paul O'Conn was
there. Jacob Burns.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Paul O'Conn was there for a couple of.
We had so many. Again, that's kind of how I got into Leeds.
I've got a funny story. Yeah, go.
No.
Your
reason with Leeds is because, well, I mean, the reason I started following Leeds, and my dad is a Manchester United fan. His brother is a Manchester City fan, and his other brother is a Liverpool fan.
Okay.
So St. Stephen's
no problem
Day,
crossing divides.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, St. Stephen's
you
Day.
Said, there's one missing
Day,
here.
As you say, Leeds. 100%. But they had just won the second division when I got into football.
Yeah.
And it was kind of a case of picking a team.
Yes.
And it was that. It was and like, what, this team are pretty that, good. There was what, a lot of there was there's a lot of history
Lee
with
Chapman?
Leeds.
Is that down?
Lee Chapman was the second season when we won the first division. Yeah. But again, that was the last time we paralleled Liverpool. Because the last time Liverpool won the league, we had won the second division, and it happened again. That's how we got promoted here. But the history, Jack Charlton was my favourite player of all time. He managed Ireland. He was Leeds captain. Granted, he won the World Cup with England, but I still like him. So there's a strong Irish connection straight through the Harry Keel's years as well, when you had Gary Kelly, Ian Hart.
Gary Kelly,
I mean, Steve McPhail, who came through them as well.
Can we talk about the coach?
Dave O'Leary's fine. My babies. Yeah, but but again, it's kind of, there's always been that.
Yes.
And for me, it would have been Leeds or would have been Everton, because they were home farm Everton, which the feeder clubs in Ireland at the time.
Yeah.
But Leeds was me, and through thick and thin, that's what it is.
I went and interviewed Harry Kewell in 2000, and this story has several levels for Leeds fans.
Yeah, come on.
But I interviewed him the day before a game, and I went there, and I went and filmed training first, and training was with Peter Reid, was the coach, and so it's the year before he leaves, I guess. So Peter Reid is, and the big game against Arsenal the next day. And they're just kicking around. O'Conn was there, Viduka, great players, all just kicking around, no one doing anything. Peter Reid comes over to where we are. We're the only camera there. And this guy, Carp, pulls up and he hops out. Ian Botham. And they just watch training, chat for an hour and a half like this. The players come and go and leave. Everyone, No mention of the game the next day. I was there. I'd been to Italy to see Grella and Bresciano about a month before, where they were walking through tactics against Bologna and saying, Baggio will be here at this point, so we have to be here. And then Baggio could be there. And so, and 45 minutes of just walking around on a football pitch, yeah. You know, at Empoli with Grella and these guys. And then I got to this and seeing this, like, go, you're right, lads. So anyway, chatting with both of them.
Yeah.
And then the next day, Viduka scores two. Oh, God. Harry Kewell scores that long ball over the top, just unbelievable.
That's
unbelievable.
His prep. That's all he needs to do. Have a good yarn.
Exactly.
Have a good yarn on the sideline. I've seen you at so many A-League men and women's games.
Yes.
Talking about the local league here, do you have a team?
No, I don't. I don't have a team, and I need a team, and I want a team.
Okay. Yeah.
It's one of those things that...
We should run a competition.
Well, it's funny, but I think it's one thing that, like, a lot of people... I mean, I've been very lucky in that I've lived around the world, and I've always made sure I've gone to follow the leagues, because I think it's so important.
Yeah.
We talked before, I lived in Sweden for a while, and I saw this player. I was like, how is this guy not a world star? He's unbelievable. Ibrahimovic, his name was. Oh. You know, he was playing for Malmo at the time.
Yeah.
And then when I lived in Los Angeles, we used to go and see the Galaxy. Yeah. So Robbie Keane came over, David Beckham came over. When we came to Australia, again, I needed to find a team. Funny enough, Millsy, I think, was playing for Victory maybe at the time. Yeah. They won the league. Yeah. That was one of the first games I've seen down there. And then I came, I said, I need to find a team. And again, it was one of the things I was aware of that... Del Piero and stuff was here, and it's hard to kind of follow just certain players. Yeah, you know, you want to know a bit about the club. I don't know enough about clubs here, I don't know enough to kind of pledge my allegiance to one. And I think as an expat, all you can really do is you can compare it to what you've seen when you've grown up. And a lot of people do that because we don't know enough about the league here, the people who play it, the fans who follow it, why they follow it.
You just go geography.
Well, but that's it.
Yeah, so when
I came first, I was like, I can't follow a team who wears red because that's Manchester United.
Yeah.
So I said, I need to find a team who wears green. And then I saw Western United. Neil Kilkenny was there. It was all matching up.
Yes.
And then I found out about Paddy Cisnarbo. I was like, well, I can't turn on him because he
was the captain.
You know, so I'm kind of. And then I was like, well, I can't follow a team in Melbourne because I need to watch people here. I need to see someone. You know. And then Andy Keogh played for Perth. He was Irish.
Yes.
He was Leeds. He was everywhere. I mean, Dad has a friend whose son plays for Brisbane Roar. So there's
that's J. O'Shea, isn't it?
J. O'Shea, who played for Bray Wanderers as well at the time. So I haven't found a team.
So you've got six teams.
I've got so many. My dad's over at the moment. We've gone to see six of the 12 A-League teams.
Have you?
I'm going to Adelaide this weekend.
Well, at least
you're
assured of having finals football.
Well, that's it. I'm fully committed to find a team, not for the novelty of it. It's because I love the game.
And I think,
again, being an armchair fan, I just think that should be the priority of the league, to get people involved.
Yeah.
You can't just rely on the fact that people love football, because people love football, but we need people to love the A-League.
Yeah.
So how can we kind of engage with people in that sense? I went to Campbelltown to watch MacArthur. Mm. How good is the cowbells?
I was like, this is the best.
I'm listening to it. But just the novelty of that. Yeah. Like, you know what I mean? The thing is, I've seen six teams. Everywhere I go, there's fans there. So why do they love this so much?
Yeah.
Why can't we talk to them and find out why they love it and why we should love it and why we should have a team that we invest in, not financially, we invest in because it's our own community, and that's what it should
Who's
be.
Who's pulled on the heartstrings? Who's had that connection with you? I guess it's like anything when you meet people, there's some that you gel with and you think, oh, that it was instantaneous or natural. When you're watching these teams, you know, each different geographical region obviously different too.
Yeah. It's hard to pick anyone in particular. I mean, I went to see Western Sydney Wanderers open their stadium because Leeds came over.
Yeah.
You know, so I
of
had
course,
that.
Yes,
the fella at the time who'd scored the goal again. Jeez, we very barely beat them. We beat them in the last minute. Pablo Hernandez scored. But there was a player called Yeboah.
Kwame Yeboah, who
had the link with Leeds because Tony Yeboah, and I looked over him. That fella's gone. He's a model now. He's beautiful. You know, so I'm not right, but I can't. I'm not follow them now. You know, Anthony Caceres, I think, is the best player in the league. I think he's unbelievable.
Yes.
You know, so Sydney FC on there, Wilco, like you're talking about, 37 years old, still one of the best fullbacks in the league. I think he's amazing. The fans that were in Campbelltown watching MacArthur absolutely love them. You know, Diamante for Western United. Paddy,
it's all the stories. That's great that
it is
true. You're in tune as well with all these stories and That's where it comes from.
Well, that's where it comes from. Like I said, the funniest thing I remember is when I went to the first game of the season, which was the Sydney Derby, Western Sydney Wanderers play Sydney FC out there.
Yeah.
And everything went up. The flares were going off. The singing was going on. It was unbelievable. The atmosphere. Yeah. I was like, I can't wait for this game. It's going to be the best. The match was rubbish. Oh, it was absolutely terrible. But I got my eye.
It was a nil-all draw.
Yeah, it was a nil-all draw. Yeah. But I got my eye for most of the game on one particular fella from Western Sydney Wanderers.
Yeah.
He was bald, he was tattooed, he was wearing pink jeans, I think. He didn't look at the game one time. He stood in front of the fans and he had them going the whole time. Yeah. And I was like, this is what you want. Yeah. This is the passion that you want. And I was like, this is going to be my team.
Well, that's the European European vibe that we have here.
It's a sidebar to that Sydney Derby story was that we were at the stadium as well and we were on air and we had a fan breach security and they nearly let themselves on to our panel and we were actually not in vision at the time, but I was looking at Georgia Yeomandale and I could see her face was like talking through the team news and it was just fear. And Pete came in and actually took him aside almost down so that he didn't jump on the panel. Yeah, so that's
it.
That was a bit of a moment.
Live TV.
If Jack Rodwell can keep fit, he is a great signing for this league.
Player.
He is class, isn't he?
Yeah. Interesting when you're telling that story. My wife hates football.
And he's a Western Sydney boy.
He is a Western Sydney boy, yeah. But my wife hates football, so I was trying to get into it. And when we lived in the UK, I took her to watch Leeds. Again, it was a muck game. It was Leeds and Charlton. I think it might have been 0-0 as well. But we took her up into the box. And then Eddie Gray was walking outside and it might have even been Peter Larmer and I just followed him. and so we're in there, so she's left in the room, my friend used to play for him, so she's left in the room talking to whoever was in that room and I'm following these legends around. And then I must have been gone maybe half an hour and then Tian heard out of Tanai, she's like, someone has breached the pitch, someone is on the pitch, and it was me and Noel Hunt. Because they left balls in the pitch, I just ran. I climbed over the barrier and I ran onto the pitch. I was booting the balls into the goal. I was like, "This is all I'm ever going to get at Ellen Road." It was one of the best days of my life.
Oh my god!
Still hates football though.
I was wondering, how did that go down with your wife?
Yeah, no, she was pretty embarrassed, but that's life.
This is an excuse to talk about because I know that we're talking about the Sydney Derby and talking about the Wanderers. There was a penalty attempted to be taken, and I just wondered what your thoughts were on this moment.
This
right here.
Look, it's unfortunate for poor old Stephen Ugarkovich, isn't it? But it can happen.
Yeah.
And it does happen.
And it happened.
And it happened.
And there you go. There it is.
That is of all. I felt really bad for him when that happened. All right. But like I said, hey, when you think about it, Lionel Messi's missed penalties.
Yeah, absolutely.
Neymar's missed penalties. Remember Pires and Henri?
Yeah, yeah. Oh, that doing their little pass, the Johan Cruyff.
That's it.
Penalty take, yeah.
And I can't say without a little dig to Harry Kewell. Remember Harry Kewell's penalty for Melbourne Heart?
Yes.
Oh, yes. Yeah, Melbourne.
I believe that Harry Kewell.
What about John
there.
Terry in the Champions League final? Didn't he put one towards
and
the corner flag as well.
And I like that Stephen Ugarkovich is now joining this conversation of football greats, of people that have had moments like that when they've gone.
Check out Neymar.
To take penalty.
Oh, Neymar this season versus Nantes or Monaco, it wasn't.
It was the weather that stuffed him.
It wasn't the talent, exactly.
It was the weather. Yeah. He slipped. Yeah. And that can happen to anyone.
Yeah, unfortunately. That's getting a lot of airtime on social media and even more.
He'll be all right. He's a good player.
He'll score the next one. Yeah.
Ugarkovich is a gun. I know we look at the title race when it comes to the Premier League, but also there's a huge FA Cup final, which will be live and exclusive on Paramount Plus. Really looking forward to this one as well. It is a third straight FA Cup final for Chelsea, and it's Chelsea v Liverpool. A lot to think about, a lot to talk about when we look at the FA Cup final. What do you think? Who's coming out with the goods?
Well, I have a soft spot from when I was a kid for Liverpool.
Yep.
Now I have a soft spot for Thiago Silva and Thomas, who I work with at PSG.
Of course.
They're really good guys, and you know they're doing it tough this season as well. There's lots happening off the field at Chelsea, which isn't easy for a football club. People, I don't think, really know how hard it is, in particular for the coach in this situation, because you've got 25, 30 players on contract who are, you know, fairly strong egos and worried about what's going to happen to the rest of their career, and you've got to try and get them to focus on football and in a cup final. So It's a difficult one for Thomas Tuchel, but Chelsea, look, it is what it is. It's two of the biggest teams in the world going into a final. You know, it's the FA Cup final. It means so much to the fans, if maybe a little less to these sets of players these days. I don't know. I find it hard to...
Well, you can see a lot of those Chelsea players are going to be out of contract at the end of the season. Exactly. They can't renew, so where are they going to go? Chelsea, they're very much a cup team.
I think Chelsea... Well, they showed that last year in the Champions League
as well. Well, that's it. I think the best thing Chelsea have gone from at the moment is that the league is nearly over. Because if this league had been any longer, they wouldn't be making top four the way they are. Yeah. But again, you can never rule out Chelsea on a one-on-one. You know, they've lost the last two FA Cup finals. They played played Liverpool three times this season. Yeah. They couldn't beat them.
Yeah.
You know, and granted, they only lost the Carabao Cup final on a penalty shootout. And if Lukaku had been the Lukaku that they signed, they would have won that game.
But it's still the same Lukaku. You've got to be able to play him. That's the whole thing. Yeah.
It'll be interesting to see, because that FA Cup final could very well be Lukaku's last game for them.
Yeah.
It'd be some point to make if he was to score the winner, being an ex-Everton player as well. But I think it's very hard to look past Liverpool. They're a juggernaut of a team.
We'll see how they go in the Champions League against Villarreal. I reckon that's they're odds-on favourites.
Yeah, yeah.
For sure, but Villarreal have stunned so many this season. Liverpool, they are built to win everything. Like Manchester City.
Yeah.
And it's not easy. Really, it's not easy to win everything with that pressure. And that's
the main thing, the pressure, because there's no expectation on Villarreal to do anything. And there's certainly an awful lot of expectation for Liverpool now going for the quad.
It is true, isn't it? They've got so many...
They've got so much.
...that they could potentially win. I mean, they can juggle the competitions, but...
That adds the pressure on himself. Last time these played each other in the FA Cup final was 10 years ago, and Chelsea won that one, did they?
Yeah.
2-1.
Yeah.
But again, there's a lot to play for, and as soon as a winning team like this loses a game, I mean, they could go down for downfall. I mean, it's the league isn't in their own hands. The rest of the three cups are.
And again,
like I said, you can't discount Chelsea. It's the first final between two German managers as well.
That's exactly what I was just going to say. Yeah. Bring it back to the Jesse Marsch future as well. The German influence and this German school of coaching. It's no surprise that the Champions League finals and FA Cup finals and racing towards the Premiership as well.
I think the main difference with this one is when Chelsea and Liverpool play each other in the league, no one wants to lose it. They're happy to take a draw, but this
Whereas
is a cup final,
and this
is the only thing that Chelsea can get out of this season.
Yeah.
Granted, they may finish top four, but that's only because no one else wants to be in top four this year. Whatever's happened to Arsenal, Spurs, and Manchester United, I'll never know.
Spurs almost stopped playing football to allow Arsenal to finish in the top four, which is such a strange conversation to be having that they're even there.
But it's going to be what Chelsea turns up on the day. But Chelsea on their day,
I'll tell
Chelsea
you, it'll
can
be the Chelsea
anyone.
That just concedes possession, doesn't want to concede a goal, defend, hit on the counter-attack, because Liverpool will impose that as well.
Yeah.
But if Chelsea can defend well enough, they'll be in it. They'll be in it.
It's with Liverpool's kind of, they have such a high press that only Manchester City can seem to beat it when they play that false nine or they don't play someone up front. It's whether Chelsea decide to go with that and use Timo Werner's pace going in behind, or if Lukaku, for some strange reason, gets a nod, I just can't see it happening.
Yeah.
But if you have Kai Havertz up front, he can always score your goals.
I'm hearing that Liverpool are well and truly in the driver's seat of this one against Chelsea. Chelsea potentially could scrape in as well.
I wouldn't be surprised if Liverpool won 4-0 on the day, to be honest with you.
Well, I like that honesty. Could you see it being such a blowout?
Penalty shooter.
I love the drama and a big morning.
Who's in goal for Chelsea?
Because
that was the problem the last time.
Yeah.
But like I said, that was Chelsea's to lose, and they lost it.
Yeah, toss a coin. Tristan MacManus, thank you so much for joining
us.
I think that whether it was 5, 10 or 15 minutes, I think it's gone for an hour. But
I'm so sorry.
Talking football with you and Robbie, it's always a pleasure. Thank you so much for joining us on Round Ball Rules. We'll see you very soon.